Right. Okay, so let's try and keep you entertained on this whole evening. I'm Glenn Parry. I work at UWE. I'm Professor of Strategy and Operations Management. I have been given 15 minutes, and normally it takes me an hour to draw breath, so I will try and entertain you and be brief and all those good things that people do. I'm going to talk about servitization in the home and a project we've been looking at on Internet of Things and personal data. So we were looking at how people use things in the home, and what we found is there's an information asymmetry in the home space. As a consumer, you have knowledge of the things you do in the home, the way you utilise your resources, what you think about the products and services that you use, and how you use them in conjunction with others. But little of that information is passed back to the manufacturer. And if you think about how many people ever tell the retailer how you used the product, what did you use it with. So suppliers lack post-sale visibilities of products in use. Context is where value is created. If we think about an umbrella as a resource, maybe it's not terribly useful when it's not raining, or even today when it's not terribly sunny. It's just you're carrying it around. But when it is raining or incredibly hot, then you've got use. So the use of the umbrella depends on the context and how you use things in combination. So you might, when we look at the way people make lunch and things like that, what services and products do they put together to create that lunch using refrigerators and maybe a cooker and Tesco's online to buy the stuff? And how do you combine it? It's always very interesting watching other people do things and understanding, oh, you do it that way and we do it different ways. We did all sorts of interesting things, watching people making lunch, doing video observations and seeing the resources and the combination of the resources. So where products are used creates variety, and when you've got variety, you've got interesting combinations and emergent resource value outcomes. It's also the starting point of the reverse supply chain. So if we can get visibility of the things you do in the home, we can start to see the things you throw away. And it gives us an idea of when stuff is starting to be sent into reuse, refuse, and these sorts of things. So, we start off with a simple question: which is most valuable, gold or polystyrene? I'm academic, so it's obviously a tricky question. And the answer is, it depends on your context. For you right now, gold is where it's at. But for this chap, it's polystyrene. And this just illustrates the importance of understanding context when we're looking at how valuable something is. The value of an offer to a consumer is only known when they integrate it into their lives. The value is not the point of sale. That's just the price. So value is difficult to capture. It's perceptual and contextual, which is really annoying. Because how much you value something depends on how you perceive it, not how I perceive it. And it depends on your context and my context, and my context is different. So capturing how good something in use is fundamentally quite difficult. Value is perceptually determined by the user within their context. You decide how valuable something is. Perceptions change with context and with new information. And we need a constant stream of new use information to understand your changing perceptions of value. So in their day, all these things were considered to be good. I used to have that computer. That's, anyone know what that is? This is the right place to ask that question.
CPC464.
With the colour monitor, not the green screen. Because I was a rich kid. So, the business needs to understand changing patterns of use. I just realised nobody's ever answered that computer question right before. I'm so pleased, you have no idea. It's kids today that I lecture. So, how do we understand and frame use and value? Well, what we use is we put value in the centre of a business model framework. And what we say is, businesses actually only produce a value proposition. What you produce as a business isn't inherently valuable, it's just proposed. This could be valuable, might not be. You decide how valuable it is only when you realize it in use. You have exchanged value at the point of sale, but you've realized value only in use and context. And hopefully, as part of the business model, the business providing that have managed to capture worth, some form of money normally, to make their business sustainable. And hopefully that reflects something that makes you happy as a consumer and makes them happy that they've captured sufficient worth. And part of the strategic balance of any business is making sure you charge enough money according to how somebody realises value and use your context. So if you understand context, you can maybe increase your prices. Currently, point of sale data is where it's at because that's what we can measure, that's the data that's available. That influences value proposition design. So by and large, business gets point of sale data from the likes of Amazon or whoever, and then say, oh, people are buying this. Let's make more of this and less of that. That's okay, but we make an awful lot of assumptions when we do that. Because we're missing context. I'll give you an example. I end up buying an awful lot of low-fat mozzarella. Because Sainsbury's is always out of full-fat mozzarella. And I know somewhere, there's somebody looking at the data going, we're doing really well on the low-fat mozzarella. No, you're not. Just because you sell to the full-fat all the time, and we all buy the low-fat, and we don't want the low-fat. Get better later. I'm so middle class. Now, you can do customer survey data. But who fills out customer surveys? Any of you? Bored people and angry people. Are you shaping your value propositions based on the bored and the angry? Actually, the Internet of Things and all these devices gives us access direct to use data. What are people doing with my stuff? If they let us. And the lawyer might say that. But actually, that's where the use data is. We're already doing that in complex engineering service systems. Things like this is the links, Rolls-Royce, if anyone hears from Rolls-Royce, you've got that sort of system on it. BAE Systems guys will know about in-vehicle health monitoring systems, health and usage monitoring systems, that basically track assets and tell you where they are, what they're doing, what the environment's like. So we're getting a lot of data. That is a very expensive way of monitoring assets, but it's becoming much, much cheaper. We're seeing it deployed right the way across, you know, industry, but we can start to move in that because it's becoming cheaper. And already Amazon have done that with a little button. If anyone uses that Amazon shopping online, you just push a button and it'll reorder something for you. So we can do that now at low cost. So we've developed a personal data platform, we call it Hub of All Things. We built this as a repository for all your personal data. It is lives in AWS. It is a personal data microserver running on Docker, for those who are into the tech stack. My knowledge of this runs out really, really quickly, but I've got techie people who can explain it. And what it does is anything with an API that is either open or hackable, we can draw in a copy of your data and hold it for you. And then because you've got effectively a microserver, you can then run little programs on it and see things about your data. The personal data micro account is owned by the individual. So the idea of this is you own your data and you can manipulate it, you can do things with it. And then you can actually choose to share it. So you can also export chunks of data, cut however you like. So we've built this, and this is useful for drawing in IoT data. And you can look at it and learn more on hubofallthings.com. So we've got a small company doing this, and we've deployed this. We've got a couple of hundred people now, but I just took six people that agreed to let me have lots of access to their data. And we used sensors, I used Z-Wave sensors, running on the Fibaro system, if anyone knows what those are, but I put lots of sensors around homes. What we were trying to do was create data density. We're academics. So we were just trying to create as much data as we could and then see what's interesting, see what we could learn. We also did lots of interviews and observations, home visits, to try and see how people live in their homes. And I tell you, people live a lot differently than you think. It's really fascinating when you go to somebody's home and you go, oh, let me watch how you live. The way people do stuff, always very different to how I do. What we decided to do for this little piece here is focus on the shower room, because that's a room you're not allowed to go in and watch. No cameras, no observations. It's private, video not acceptable. It's also wet. So it's very difficult to get good sensor data. And we're not allowed to use mains power. So we thought, this is a tough room to crack. How can we understand context of use? First thing we did was ask people to categorize and say, you know, what is in the chat room? What are the resources that you have in there? And you have a lot of stuff in your shower room. Like, loads of stuff. I mean, it's a chemist, it's all sorts of stuff. Lots of taps and resources. What we did was analyze the way we use those resources and looked at how we could collect data on it. And what we found was a categorization of the way you interact with resources and use resources and how we capture data. And we found interaction data, that's data from things, resources, that when you interact with them, they're not transformed, diminished, or depleted. So things like a shower door, when you open it, or a tap. And we can capture data on those using, you know, count measures or little actuators. Then we find experience data, what we call experience data. And that's where we put sensors on things, and we realized they were not transformed really, but they were slightly diminished. Things like towels, flannels, and in the kitchen, dishes, plates, cups, mugs. So you're experiencing those items, but you're not really diminishing them. You know, you use them once, maybe wash them, then use them again. Then we look at depletion data. These are resources that are consumed at a high rate to which they replenish. So these are things like tins of beans, your bottles of shampoo. And we look at consumption data, and these are resources that are consumed at the rate of consumption. And then they're replenished at the rate of consumption. So things like water, Wi-Fi, and electricity. So they're coming into the house at the same rate that you use them. And we can use, you can imagine we're thinking about, well, what sort of sensors do we use to measure those things. And this gives us a really useful categorization for all the resources we use. There are also obviously nesting functions, because over time a tap will wear out. But we've got to think about the chronology, and if you were to use this sort of thing, you've got to think about, well, what's our time period, what's our unit of analysis to get the right measure. So, example of interaction data, this is the shower room, and we've got loads of sensors we employed. That's the Z-Wave humidity sensor. And you can see from the peaks, the humidity sensor is telling me two things. Firstly, when the shower's being on, it shows me the dwell time for how humid it is. But it also gives me an indication of the functionality of the extractor fans. And those decay peaks are different according to which house we looked at. And it gave us an indication of how big the room was and how good the ventilation was, where the windows were open and that sort of thing. So already we're seeing we can tell multiple things from a single sensor. Anyone know where the picture's from?
Paris Bueller.
It gives us a count of the interaction. So actually, using a humidity sensor, we don't need to measure the interaction with taps and shower, because that tells us. So that's quite neat. I put a flood sensor that you can buy. These are typically things you'd stick under a dishwasher that tells you when something's leaking. But we hot-wired it and stuck it in the shower tray. So it would then say, when you've got the water running, tell me when the water's on and also when it turns off again. So that gave me average shower time. And because you can measure the rate of water flow, showers are between 8 and 15 litres a minute. And that tells me how much water is being used. How long are you in a shower for? 5 minutes? Bloody lies. Sorry, I swore on camera. Didn't you do that? No, what we found was most people are in the shower about 15 minutes. People are in the shower a lot longer than they think they are. And you use quite a lot more water than you think you do. So it's... there we go, at the bottom. Average shower was 149 litres of water, we were finding, whereas the bath only 80 litres. So actually we're consuming a lot more water than we think there are, and people are drifting off in the shower. I was only for 5 minutes, maybe for a quarter an hour. This data gives us a count of the interaction in the shower, consumption of water. Again, much longer than we thought. That's not me. I'm taller than that. I've got probably the only internet-enabled towel. But what I did was I put a motion sensor on the towel. So whenever it was used, it sort of flopped around, and you know, you got the motion, and therefore you could count the amount the shower was being used. And these are counts of amount of towel usage. This was really interesting. Do you all have your own towel in the bathroom?
Yes.
Not. You really don't. Because it appeared that my towel was being used all the time. It's a big game. I just wash my hands. Use James' towel. Not what you think. I don't see towels. They're the feature. Others are drying their hands on my towel at some of these points. Shampoo, we colleagues at Cambridge University, we were working with, developed this really nice, called the Automatic Beauty Box. It was a little internet-connected scales, effectively, where you scanned anything with a barcode, you could scan it, put it in, when you take it out, you scan it, and it was just a difference engine, so you're calculating the rate of depletion of anything with a barcode, you could take it in. And we got these really nice linear depletion rates on shampoo. And you can see the value of that immediately for the likes of Procter & Gamble, because we know those monthly replenishment, you know, here's another box, sort of what, a Grays box, yeah, everyone signs up for that, and won't put to you cancel it, you know. Whereas this, you're only ever going to get what you need if you make your shampoo bottles IoT enabled. Because they can see, oh, you're about to run out, send you another. Or if they could get access to my calendar, go, oh, Glenn's about to go on holiday, he's going to need this much more to go on holiday with than a small bottle. Wouldn't that be great? I'm all for it. Nice linear functions. This was a shower gel, and you can see it's not, we lost the linearity there. It was erratic. We didn't know why. It felt to me like that should be linear too, but because we have a bit of observation, and we can then, using the hub of all things, we can cut up some data. We found that the dog, somebody had knocked this particular bottle over, and shower gel everywhere, so there was a big fall. Fine. But there was also these steps. And we looked at correlations within the data set, and there was a strong correlation to the Fitbit data. And every time the individual went running, shower time and shower gel increased by 100%. So they're doubling up after running. So there's a correlation between exercise and shower time, shampoo consumption. Super interesting, you wouldn't have got that with that data density. Clearly Nike needs to step into the showering market. So findings, this is explorative IoT, looking at data density, finding some of the, just some of the neat things we can find. Operationalizing it in the home has been a lot of fun. Sticking sensors all over my house without my kids breaking them or my wife objecting to them. So really having to deal with those sensitivities that are real. You know, people don't like to be measured. I do have an IoT-enabled toilet well holder. but it shows use and combination of resources and provides a characterization of consumption types. That's been quite useful. So we can see, we can think in terms of those different categories about what is this resource and therefore how might we measure it in a useful way. Lots of things you can study, looking at time, looking at consumption rates, patterns. Remembering, you know, this is real data. Survey data wouldn't have surfaced any of these things. Some activities we can see are moderators for others. You know, the running leads to the shower gel consumption. So there's a paper we've written on this. It is open access. It's online. You can just freely download it. There's some books. I've got my Twitter handle up there. That's a hub of all things. I've got a YouTube channel if you want to hear me talk about any of this stuff. But hopefully that's
not bad.
That's very good for an academic, trying to do 15 minutes.
Thank you, Glenn.